Hi, you guys. Good morning on this Sunday. Hi, Faith. I'm excited for this scope. I've been gone for a while, but I'm glad I'm back. Hi, Sarah. Hello, hello, good morning. I'm going to introduce myself for anybody that's new. Hi, Janice. Hi, Audrey. I'm going to talk about how I've been using my journal with layers of false self that I know we all do. Also, about my planner that has been so fun. Hello, using watercolor. It's been really, really great. Hey, Elizabeth. Oh, yeah, 2:30. That's your time, isn't it? The watercolor's been fun. I don't know if anyone else has been using it, but it's definitely been amazing. Me and my son also had a wonderful time visiting with people that are going to be creating our books and our art. So that was fun for the launch of the new site. But creating the life you want and scripting it by the day and being detailed. Hey, Nancy. And it's just so much fun and getting into the details. And all of this planning is not as wonderful if you know who our true authentic selves are. And I've been reading some really great books. Hello. Oh, yay. I'm so glad. Because you know, our planners can really take on an amazing purpose for us if we truly know and can take off the false imposter voices and the layers of false self off of us so that we can find our core. If you're new to me, my name is Jenny Pettin. I'm a homeschooling mom of eight, and I empower women to plan beyond their to-do list and to be able to identify themselves outside the roles they play. So, I mean, virtually, we want to be able to know who we are outside being our children's mother, a wife. Hello. Hey, Alana. You know who we truly are. And, you know, I know we all deal with this, and it's going to be all on different degrees. And I know I do, and that's why it did take me so long to unearth who I truly was. And what happens, and what can happen, I'm going to tell you some great book reads, too, that I've been reading and have I even been inspired by. But we create, when we're either had experienced any kind of trauma or even more of a benign kind of negativity or negative voices, when we're young or when we're old, it doesn't matter. When we hear it, a lot of times what we'll do is, if left unchecked, is that we just kind of layer it on top of our souls. It becomes part of who we are. Then something else negative comes along. So let's say someone says something negative, or they think you're stupid, or when you're young, you were fat, or you're not pretty, or you could never write that book, or all of that. Those kinds of false negativity create these layers. And that's why, and you know, a big part of why I keep addressing this is because I do get messages about this, direct messages about it. Absolutely it does, because our true self would never talk that way, and so it gets covered up. And our true authentic selves is, it's speaking to us, hey, but you know, it gets completely muffled by all of the negativity and all of that. So we have to be able to check out those emotions. I know, and be able to take them off and peel them off and look at them. And so every time we get these fears, or we don't know who we are, or we don't think we have talents, we have to look at that negativity and see where it's coming from. Exactly, because this, we want to be able to identify who we are and to work from our authentic self, because that's how we'll truly find and take action off of our authentic selves, which is what we are designed to do. So instead, what we'll do is we'll take action off of the imposters. And that's what we don't want to do, because that's when we're going to find ourselves in dead-end places, depressed in the home, yada, yada, yada. Now, I think the hugest thing is awareness. And I've said this before. once you're aware that you're working off of imposter voices, or once you're aware that you are dealing off of a false self, or you're working off of negativity, then now you can do something about it. And so it's huge. Now, there were things in my past where it's with my family, my upbringing, that it has been something that I've dealt with. So there's been things where I had a dad who was, I have a dad who is a child of an alcoholic, and I have a mother who was horribly sexually abused as a child. So we've had some issues as them being parents. And so it's been really, really hard, though I feel for them and what has happened. Unfortunately, it has had there's been a lot of negative effects on my life, you know, and what I and who I thought I was, and it caused codependency and unauthenticity. And I didn't know who I was. I almost thought I was my mom. And the impact can continue, and I broke the cycle. And it's been very, 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 very hard. However, it's been amazing. Yeah, sometimes you just have to identify these, and you have to do it. Yeah. Now, and it's funny because, and you can have the effects huge with that. And it's funny how even my dad never drank, but he was a child of an alcoholic who never resolved issues. So that was, you know, it was hard. So, you know, what we need to do is we need to identify why we feel the way we feel, and work through all of those negative things and rewrite. This is what I've learned. You rewrite, and it's been working for me. It's been awesome. You rewrite the negative story. So this is what I've been doing. Let me tell you two books that I've been greatly influenced by. Number one, there's also EFT and tapping. I want you to look into it. It's too much for me to do right here. But I want you to look it up if you feel that this is something that you need. I'd look up EFT. It's a great way to also rewrite the story of things that go in your mind that you need to rewrite. Okay, whether benign or traumatic, both. It'll help cycle it through. There's no more ruminating, and you can actually process it. You know how you ruminate over things that someone either said negatively or that's happened to you negatively, and you think you're crazy, or did you hear them right, or stuff like that. When you've been manipulated, or that manipulation, people manipulate you, that's a big one. You tend to ruminate. You're like, why did that happen to me? Or because I know it's happened to me a gazillion times. In order to get through it, I've done some tapping and I've rewritten stories. So one book, I didn't even say it, here it is. It's by Laura Coe, and it's called Emotional Obesity, and it's a phenomenal book. I highly recommend it. Now, I do come from a Christian perspective. She's very new agey. However, I benefited from the book tremendously. It's something I think everybody should read. I definitely do, and I think you should check it out. And remember when I talked, if anyone from here from before, I talked about the Gabriel method? It's about losing weight. And I'll tell you what, a lot of times we develop physical symptoms from emotional traumas and the negativity that we layer on over our souls over the years. Our bodies actually hold on to fat cells and don't even release it, even though we're dieting and doing all these things. That's temporary. That's why it's temporary. Because of the fact that your body is in survival mode, because it doesn't tell the difference between actual physical harm and emotional harm. So what it's doing is it's a safety. Your body is trying to take care of you. So if you're stressed or anxious, I'll get physical symptoms. For a while there, I was starting to chew ice. I didn't connect the dots, but you need to start connecting dots, because the awareness is, I would start to chomp on ice. I'll pick my face. I'll bite the skin around my nails. I'd have anxiety. I haven't had those in a little while because I've been working through it, which has been great. But that is one of the reasons why that we hold on to fat. I mean, and you notice how we go through these. That's why I hate controlling food. So what do? We control food instead of trying to actually work through some emotional traumas and emotions that we've had. Hey, Monica. It's so imperative that we do it. And it's great to be healthy and whole, because if you think about it, and that way we can stay on top of it each time, like, whoa, here comes a negative thing. Now I need to rewrite that. And we process it immediately. It makes us better mothers. And then to be our authentic selves. That way we don't pass things along. We're not reacting to things all the time. You know how you get in reactive mode and you react to your family all the time, or you react to your kids instead of, you know, and otherwise you would have assessed a situation. Oh, really? Oh, I've always been an ice chomper. I have not always been an ice chomper. I just recently was one. And I was like, this is so bizarre. Is it, am I anemic or something? My kids were like, what are you, crazy? I mean, I was obsessed. And so it's something to explore. So let's just say this. I will say one thing that my mom, I don't want to go on here and rant about all the different things that happened, but I will say one thing that did stuck out, because I'm going to show you how I have rewritten it. But when it came time, now my mom has struggled. She had PTSD, post-traumatic stress from all the things that had happened to her. I really do feel that I actually have, it's been hard for me to see that that has happened to her. However, when it turned around and cycled to me, and over the years and years and years, I no longer could even have a relationship with her anymore. So one of the things that she did say to me when I was getting married, and is, she goes, I don't, you know, she had said, I was looking at dresses, and I had a daughter outside of wedlock. My oldest is outside of who's not my husband's biologically. Then I met my husband when she was two and we got married. So here's how that works. So here I'm going to be getting married. And I'm looking through these dresses. I'm so excited. This is an exciting time. I would have loved my Abby to have been with me. And she said, I don't know who you think you are looking through those dresses and looking at white dresses of any kind. That's what she said to me. And then she continued to say, why don't you go ahead and just elope? And you can just, you know, I'll watch Abby. You just go. I'll give you $1,000. You leave. That'd be the best thing for you to do. Okay, so that is one example that has stuck in my head for the very longest time. So what you do, this is how you rewrite that kind of a story. So if you've had any kind of negative, or someone said something that was cold and cruel, we tend to put that over our soul and we just kind of keep it there, you know, and we kind of coddle it. What you do is you sit there and you get in that same moment and you can say, yeah, you can say, okay, you get that in that place, and then you're going to go ahead and rewrite it. So instead, I'm looking through magazines, and I'm seeing these beautiful dresses, and I say, and I act out what my mom, what I would have loved my mom to have said. So she could have said, oh, Jenny, I'm so excited to look at dresses with you. This is a very wonderful time. I cannot wait. I want everyone to see you when you get married, all of our family, all of our friends, and I want Abby to be the flower girl and to be part of this beautiful time. Okay, I am rewriting that story. You might need to do it a couple times, but rewrite it. Rewrite the story. Yes, and it helps. This is how you can process it. The EFT kind of does the same thing. It's a matter of tapping and acupuncture by tapping on the, you know, on the exterior of your bodies. But this can also help too, just to process steps. Rewrite the story and peel off the layers. There is some really amazing things that this Laura Coe, author of Emotional Obesity, has taught me. Another scoper that I want you to go check out is Dr. Michaela Serrano. Okay, she's a scoper. I want you to find her because she really helps you get unstuck, and she's a psychotherapist who helps with the brain and talks about how the brain, we need to identify the brain as a separate entity. Like, you can actually take the brain off and put it over here, because your brain is actually taking things in, and we don't have to listen to everything it's putting in. So anyway, I don't want to get into her too much. She's like intense and she's amazing. So if you're into this and you feel like that's something that you would like, go find her, Dr. Michaela Serrano. She's on Periscope and I'm crazy about her. And she has a website and she'll tell you about that. So let me read you just a couple things of what I've read out of that book. She said, you have to lay down the burden of any emotional weight, all the layers, all the negative emotions, the learned values even that maybe your parents imposed, self-imposed limitations and judgment, Even if you thought you got over them, you know how you think you just get over something? You really don't. They were still there, wrapped around the spirit and muting its voice. So that's what it's, oh, I'm going to look that up. Brain spotting. I'm going to look it up. It's muting your true voice. And so you know how we, that's how we get stuck. And here we are, moms, you know, you're loving your life, and all of a sudden you're like, who am I? You know, what am I good at? And you just plan to-dos. That's really the whole thing of the story. Here comes a memory. That's like post-traumatic stress where it come pops out. And that's just, we need to work through it all. And so we exactly. And we need to you know, we have such a very big responsibility as mothers. We really, really do. This is for us and for our families and our children to be able to work through some things. So we're making sure that we're working through and rewriting some negative stories so we can work and we can act off of our authentic selves. And when we're acting off of our authentic selves, we're always going in the right direction. Okay. I love that. It said, our negative thoughts will stay there as long as I avoid them. A mere comfortable option. So they're going to stay there as long as you avoid them. So you know how they come or you have physical symptoms and you don't know what it is and you just stuff it down or you just get over it or you hear something and you just get over it. You get over it. You just try to get over it. It's always going to be there and you're just adding layers over the soul. So you don't want to do that. We are conditioned to move on, ignore it, and don't stop and don't look. So we're kind of conditioned to that. We don't want to be conditioned to that. We want to be able to look at it. And because you know why? Because when we engage our emotions, it makes us feel bad. Who wants to look at the fact that your mom said you can't wear a white dress or that, you know, leave? No, you know, we're not gonna. No one's gonna be there at your wedding, by the way. Neither is your daughter. Who wants to go back and look at that? You know what I mean? But we got to. And I will say, for going back and processing emotions like this, sometimes it can be really, you know, it's like, oh, geez. There's this EFT method. Within that, there's a way to be able to so that you're not so effective, you're not so boldly going into that emotion so you can avoid it being so painful. It's less painful. So if you look on EFT, there's that. If it's something that you need, emotional nutrition, feed yourself nourishing thoughts. Oh boy, that's not good. Yeah, and I think, you know, mom issues as daughters, it's something to look at sometimes if, you know, at least sometimes they're severe, sometimes they're not. I feel I'm dealing with, I think, a borderline narcissistic mother, and it's been very, very difficult. And it's been good for me to be able to look at it and to process it and to say, wow, I'm not crazy. And instead of reacting or not, or being codependent or acting like I don't have a brain or naive because only my mom knows something, I've had to be able to work through it and process it. And it's been amazing. And that's why it's helped with finding my authentic self, finding more of what I'm good at, finding that I actually can think for myself. All of these things are amazing to find out. So all of this effort and all of this work, which may seem hard and may seem scary, is all very worth it for you in the end. And you need to do it. You have to do it. Also remember, our emotions are telling us something. So you can't ever really stuff them. Our emotions are telling us something. If you push it away or ignore it, oh, thank you. If you push it away, you're gonna miss what it's telling you. It's telling you something. And even your physical symptoms, your body is telling you something. If you're chomping on ice and poking at your nails and picking your face and binging, I used to be a binge eater in my 20s. I mean, hi, Celeste. You're such a joy. Precious to me is amazing. You need to go follow her. She's so full of joy and inspiration. I tell you, it is difficult. And if you go, it is difficult and there's a lot of pain. And like I said, if you go through, if you do EFT, there is a way so you do not have to go through such hardcore emotions. You can kind of touch on it and then process it. So make sure you do look that up. It is good for our kids' emotional being and you can help them through things like that too. So you need to investigate these feelings. Are they pertaining to the present moment? If anything kind of negative or anything like that, or fear, anything happens in the present moment, you need to look at it and say, am I feeling something from my memory, or am I feeling something from the present moment? So EFT, yes, and it'll pop right up. There's so much on it. Please look at it. It's very beneficial for all of us. And our bodies will tell us messages all the time. There's physical symptoms from emotional traumas that are unresolved. So it's a very good thing to be kind of looking at. So the biggest thing is changing our mindset to accept our emotional life. A lot of times we think it gets in our way. It's like, well, I don't have time for this. You know what I mean? And you just put it away. We don't have time to not look at it. These are all of the way we were made and created. These emotions are telling us something, and we need to look at it, and we need to investigate it, and that brain spotting better for long-term resolution. Okay, I have never heard of that, and I will have to look at that, and it sounds just like what I, by rewriting your story or by EFT, it does help process that. Let's see. It's these unresolved issues that create imposter voices. So that's, oh, she was an alcoholic. That had to have been very, very hard. Shadow work. Okay. I haven't heard of that either. I'll have to look at that. Unresolved issue, they can create imposter voices. So then we're virtually acting off of a false self, imposter voices. Like you could never, like in your head, you think it's in your head, you know, it says, you could never write that book. Who do you think you are? You could never tell other women about this. Who do you think you are? You don't know nothing. Or you're too fat to wear that. You're not pretty enough, so why even put makeup on? Or you know what I mean? Those imposter voices. You don't want to, those are triggers that you need to go and look at to see where they're coming from. So you need to make sense of the voices that you're listening to, and to make sure that it whether it's your authentic self. You cannot always trust your thoughts even when they sound like you. So you need to be very aware of that. Your authentic voice will never contradict your value system. So you need to remember that. And that came out of the emotional obesity book. Your true voice will never come from a negative place and will never make you feel bad about yourself. So remember that. So when you do feel bad about yourself, then you need to find out why. Don't let it go, even if you got to leave the room for a minute or whatever. Go figure that out. And then after we get all these emotional layers off, it's the keeping on top of it that's really kind of the easy part. And we can kind of, you know, take care of our emotional well-being and our emotional health that way. Your authentic voice is there still telling you something. It's just mixed in with the crowd of the negative voices. So it's there. It's just crowded. So that's why sometimes, like, even when if you are new to me, you wouldn't know this, but before, when I finally heard the nudge of God telling me, hey, you know what? You do have talents and a gift and a purpose. This is what I want you to pursue, is a small little nudge. I feel like that was God pushing and pushing through a lot of the false self that I had on top of me. It was something that I don't feel I could have done without God doing that. I had a lot of emotional layers at that time. And that was a little nudge that started the unveiling and the awareness and a slow journey process. But it was something that I did hear that said, wow, I am something other than my children's mother just existing. So that was very, very powerful. Sometimes even just journaling that I know what that must be like, Audrey. And God is the reason why we get through. I mean, man, without God, I don't know how people do it without God. Moving in a direction that honors your true self will feel, it will feel right despite the challenges. So that's also something to remember. When fear and negative emotions pop up, we need to find out where it originates. Yes, he does. Elizabeth, thank you. The tension in your body and the negative messages in your mind are signs that your voice has been hijacked. So remember that too. And commit to your feelings by slowing down, breathe. And I love this part, what Laura Coe said. She said, let them pass through without latching onto them. So I love that. Slow down. If you start to get negative feelings or stuff like that, commit to your feelings by slowing down, breathe, let them pass through without latching on. Let them pass through. The brain, and like I said from that Dr. Michaela Serrano, the brain is like a separate entity, actually. Kind of taking input. And negative thoughts are our imposter voices. And we have identified ourselves with these thoughts, mistaking them for who we really are. The biggest tip is awareness. The goal of of getting in shape emotionally is to become aware of what we think, because what we think guides our lives. I mean, that's pretty powerful. You want to make sure you're getting these emotional layers off, because you're always going to be unhappy until you can get those off. Who do you want me to, Laura Coe, Coe is the last name, Dr. Michaela, DrMacayla, Serrano, Sarano. I hope that helps. I plan on doing a blog post about this at Planner Perfect, so you know. Oh, I'm sorry. Planner Perfect. Is it catch.me/PlannerPerfect? That's going to be there. Being emotionally well is not only vital to who we want to become, but for the people that are under our influence. That's my own voice saying that. Isn't that just the biggest truth? I mean, as mothers, I look around at my huge family, all of my children, and thank you. Is your name Donna? Gifts from God. I'm like, wow. I'm like, wow, that is a huge influence. We have such a huge influence. And I want to make sure that I'm living off authentically. And I will say, this is, and I will preface, this is me and my journey and what I've learned, and I'm not a therapist. So I want to preface that. I'm sure everyone knows that already. But yeah, no, I'm not a therapist, but I have come a long way and I've learned quite a bit and I've read a lot. And I think that we can definitely, people who have been on a road before us, it does catch us safe scopes. Exactly. That's how I view it, and that's how I look at it too. And I have been able to kind of cut the cycle, which has been amazing. Not that I had narcissistic traits or those kind of traits my mother did, but because I was codependent, I couldn't make a move without her. And so I wasn't living independently of her, which was very, very hard. Plus, I had negative thoughts all the time. I thought I was too fat, or I wasn't pretty enough, or my art wasn't good enough, because she always had something to say about it. Always. She's like, well, that's not really what I had envisioned. You can keep it if I would paint something for her. So I never thought my art was good enough. So I shelved the art for about 20 years of my life. And so, anyway, that's why it's so important to look through. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You guys are so sweet. That we look through it and we do the CFT and we process these tips and process these negative thoughts so that we can do it. And it does make you better. You learn so much from this. I am such a better person from going through this. I have learned a tremendous amount, and God will get us through it, and I've been able to work through it, and it's been great being able to be aware. That's like, that saves you right there, because it's like, wow, I'm eating ice right now. I gotta go see. I need to understand what triggered it. And sure enough, there were things that were triggering me doing that. So, or when I start to pick my face or something, my husband will say, "You're doing it again," and I'll say, "Oh gosh," you know what I mean? I mean, it starts to go there. Or, so, oh, thank you. That's such a sweet thing to say. So I've always got to keep track of it, and I'm really interested. I mean, it is, I think it's phenomenal about the whole weight thing. I mean, of course, I've had 8 kids, and the whole dieting thing, dieting's been my life. And I just we do yearn for their approval. And I think it's important that, and healthy, that not only that, of course, we love them unconditionally, but I think it's important to teach our children that they don't need our approval to be who they are. I think that that's really, really important. I've learned that too. I mean, to always be stuck on if your mom is going to approve of you, you need to be able to feel content and good in who God had made you all on your own. Hey, Rita, Love you. You need to feel good about yourself and who you are and how you've been made without your mom's approval. Not saying that you don't need your mom's approval, because we do. But when we don't get it, it's one of those things that we need to understand and know. And I just don't want my kids to think that you have to have my approval or you're nobody. You know what I mean? And yes, and proud of them. Yeah, my dad was actually just a really funny guy until he got mad. And then he never really did or taught me anything. He never hugged me because he just, that wasn't his bag. So he never hugged or touched any of us like that. Yeah, and that's how I look at it with mine. I'm telling you, I gotta go try to find this on my feed somewhere in Facebook and like delete it in case someone in my family finds it, you know? But I want to be cautious, and I don't want to start sitting here. They, you know, she's alive and well, so I'm not going to be on here like doing a mom bash because I don't think it's appropriate. However, I do think it's important that we can share stories and things that can help others if they are stuck with identifying who they are, where they're going, and taking off those emotional layers. Yeah. Disapproval. I've had it. Or if you don't act, mine was if you don't act the way they want you to act, then you're in trouble. And be careful who you're talking to. And you better obey me because I'm the authority figure and I know more than you. And that was always something that was very hard. And I always felt like I didn't know anything. Only wiser, older, and more people in authority did. So, anyway, that's my thoughts for today. I know I'm very inconsistent. It is true. You don't need your mom's approval. As long as I have God's approval, it's good. That's what I was really trying to convey, even though I'm very proud of my children. I love my children. I will always express my love for them and unconditional love and how happy I am where they were going. But I'm even expressing you do not need my approval to know that you were made by God and who you are. You have God's approval, and that's who you are. I don't ever want them to get stuck in their head that without my approval, they're nothing. And that's what I want from them. So when they even show me things, I'm like, wow, I think that's awesome. But I'm like, how do you think about that? You know, what do you think about what you just did? You know, I think that's more important. But thanks for stopping in today in the room. I know I'm inconsistent with my scopes, but I have so many kids that sometimes I've got to. Yeah. Oh, I'm so glad. Oh, hey, Sid. I'm crazy about you, of course, and can't wait to see you tonight. And thanks, Donna. Thanks for stopping in. Thank you, Audrey. I have just really come to know you and appreciate you. God bless you too. And until next time, guys, I will be back soon, I promise, with more good things about planning and just bettering our lives as mom. Yeah, I do ask them that. It's really important. Yes. Oh, I love you, Rita. Oh. Joe, hey, you're on here. Oh, thank you. Wonderful. Thanks, Nancy. Thanks for popping in. I will be back soon this week. Oh, I'm so glad, Elizabeth. And we will chat more on just being better women and really just getting to the core of ourselves and planning and having a wonderful time, planning our hearts out, okay, for a life that we were created to live. So until next time, girls, bye-bye.